This episode was suggested by several listeners, Kevin J. and Susan P. from Patreon, Harlan's Emporium, and Undeader Than Thou from Instagram, Heather B. on Twitter, and many more. This episode contains discussions of the reproductive system, sex, sexual abuse, masturbation, and misogyny. If these subjects aren't things you want to hear about, you may want to skip this episode. Also, the themes touched upon in this episode are complex. Elements that might not have been contentious then are now. Therefore, discussing them and forming conclusions involves a level of objectivity which can be hard to achieve from a modern perspective. Please keep these difficulties in mind. Humans are fascinated by gore and violence, but even more so, the mysterious and unsolved. Interest in these disturbing and unpleasant subjects is called morbid curiosity, and it has gripped hundreds of people throughout the ages. I am one of those people. My name is Hallie, and this is the Morbid Curiosity Podcast. Last time on the MCP, we discussed the supposed origins of hysteria in ancient Greek medicine and revealed that though this origin story is widely believed to be true, it's not. It's more likely the medical historians of the 17th through 20th century searched the ancient Greek texts, found the word hystera, meaning womb, and hysterika, meaning of the womb, and due to the similarity of the word, assumed it meant the same thing. They also interpreted several phrases, such as customary remedies and anointing the genitals, to mean masturbation. It was in this way that the so-called disease and the treatment that is said to have become traditional were legitimized later. However, we'll get to that later in this episode. Early Greek physicians believed most of the diseases of women stemmed from the uterus or womb. Some thought the womb wandered throughout the body, suffocating the other organs, while others thought the retention of fluids in the womb, namely female seed, which is likely an incorrect understanding of normal vaginal lubrication, caused disease. Treatments, therefore, circulated around moving the womb back into place with marital sex, scent therapy, and massage, or expelling the seed through marital sex, childbirth, or anointing the vagina with oil. During the Middle Ages or medieval era, the medical discoveries of the ancient Greeks were mostly set aside as Christian Europe moved away from pagan traditions and texts. The humoral system of medicine, a holistic system which depended on the balancing of four vital energies, blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile, collectively known as the four humors, was still in use at this time, despite its pagan origin. Any symptoms that were unidentifiable or couldn't be cured with this system, however, were blamed on witchcraft or the devil. Treatments for these symptoms involved exorcisms and sometimes burning the supposed witch at the stake. There was some medical writing and research in the early part of the Middle Ages, mostly based on herbal treatments and the ancient Greek writings. There was still some trepidation surrounding the treatments for what was called suffocation of the womb, which refers back to the wandering womb and the retention of female seed. The treatments, as interpreted by the medieval physicians, were a form of genital massage, which caused the woman experiencing the symptoms to expel the seed, which was now interpreted as an orgasm. The morality of this treatment was unclear, as it involved pleasure and arousal, which were sins if not between husband and wife. Therefore, medieval physicians acknowledged the existence of this treatment, but did not often recommend it. They too relied on scent therapy and balancing the humors. By the end of the Middle Ages, where we left off, science and medicine were just beginning to make an appearance again, and women's health was becoming of more interest to male physicians. As I mentioned in part 1, Ambrose Paré, a French barber surgeon, wrote on the field of obstetrics in the early 1600s. His pupil, Jacques Guimond, wrote an entire book on the practice of midwifery, an area of medicine that had previously been a women-only field. However, most of Europe was still under the impression that witches and demons were the cause of many illnesses, especially sudden, violent, and unexplainable illnesses. One of the first instances of the reappearance of a natural medical diagnosis for the symptoms of what was later called hysteria was a treatise written by Edward Jordan at the end of the Elizabethan period in 1603. Queen Elizabeth I had just died, destabilizing the Church of England, which she supported during her reign. This instability gave the Catholic and Puritan churches incentive to try and gain a foothold in England. The three religious groups vied for legitimacy, and this manifested as a rise in accusations of witchcraft and exorcisms. Through exorcisms, these religious sects were trying to prove their religion was truly backed by God, as was shown by their ability to exorcise demons. The title of Jordan's treatise was A Brief Discourse on a Disease Called the Suffocation of the Mother, where mother is used in place of womb. However, while he defended women against accusations of witchcraft, he also seemed to view women as the victims of their own bodies, particularly their wombs. Jordan also harkens back to the ancient Greek physician Hippocrates, stating that virginal maidens and widows were the most prone to hysteria, as they lacked the benefit of marriage and were deprived of sexual activity, which created a congestion of humors and corruption around their wombs. He also believed in the wandering womb theory. This is in fact the first text in the English language to discuss the wandering womb and the first to link hysteria with Hippocrates. Jordan wrote his treatise after a witchcraft trial he had testified in had resulted in the punishment of a so-called witch for bewitching a 14-year-old girl named Mary Glover. Glover's symptoms included convulsions, blindness, mutism, swelling in the neck and throat, and a lack of sensation on her left side. Doctors were brought in to examine the girl, which was not standard procedure in witchcraft trials. However, they had no definitive diagnosis, nor prescribed a method of treatment. Therefore, the witch was imprisoned, and Glover underwent many exorcisms by both Catholic and Protestant priests as treatment. At the time, Jordan was ridiculed for his theory that disease was the cause, not witches. Even though his work contains some of the incorrect ideas about the wandering womb, some scholars see his work as a milestone in the re-medicalization of hysteria and removing the supernatural explanation that grew up around it during the medieval era. There was no new work on hysteria for around 20 years when the Enlightenment era began to take hold in Britain and Europe. The Enlightenment, an age of reason and philosophy, began in the late 1600s. It was a time of growing rebellion against misogyny and the rise of philosophy and intellectualism. Belief in witchcraft faded, and madness became a matter for physicians again. Even so, some previous medical theories prevailed, such as humorism. The last of the large witch hunts in America occurred in 1692 with the Salem witch trials. Even at the time, the incident was seen by some as an outbreak of hysteria, in which the Puritans misinterpreted the symptoms as witchcraft. The symptoms described during the events at Salem were staring, making random noises, laughing, jumping, and sudden movements. The trials resulted in a total of 19 people being hanged and hundreds more imprisoned. Don't worry, we'll definitely do an episode on this subject in the future. As belief in witchcraft faded, the study of anatomy, and especially the central nervous system, rose. Thomas Willis, who is modernly known as the father of neurology, published two works in the late 1600s that described a concept he called animal spirits, a more spiritual version of the present-day idea of nerve impulses. He stated that any dysfunction in these animal spirits could cause pathology, and those who had explosive properties in their animal spirits could develop epilepsy, hysteria, or hypochondriasis. In his work, hysteria was defined as difficulty in breathing, chest pain, abdominal distension, and outbursts of weeping and laughter. He felt hysteria had its origins not in the womb, but in the brain and nervous system, as this is where emotions and physical symptoms were generated. Hypochondriasis was the male version of hysteria, which made Willis also the first person to suggest that men could suffer from a similar nervous disorder. Willis's ideas on animal spirits and nervous pathology were not generally accepted, but his efforts in describing and medicalizing hysteria and other nervous disorders were a stepping stone to later work on neurology. Thomas Sydenham, who was later known as the English Hippocrates, and who I spoke about briefly in part one, was a huge proponent of the Hippocratic system of medicine. In 1682, he published Dissertatio Epistolaris, meaning Dissertation on the Letters, in response to another physician asking Sydenham for advice on hysteria. In this letter, Sydenham went into great detail on the symptoms of hysteria, why it affects mostly women, and how to treat it. In brief, he stated that it affected women due to their fragility and sedentary lifestyle, and that some men could also be affected if they were fragile and sedentary, but that the male form was called hypochondria. Hysteria and hypochondria resembled almost all other diseases and had a variety of symptoms. Here are just a few from his long list: apoplexy, violent convulsions, bloating of the belly, inhuman strength, muttering, headaches with vomiting from the pain, coughing, random pains, hard tumors in the jaws, shoulders, hands, thighs, and legs, anguish, despair, excessive laughter, excessive crying, the need to urinate frequently, irritability, and anger. As you can see, these symptoms are both emotional and physical, and some resemble conditions we know today, such as migraines, depression, and epilepsy. Sydenham suggested a cause for hysteria that seems to combine the theories of Willis and the Hippocratic texts, stating that the animal spirits of the body must be rightly disposed of through menstruation or expulsion of female seed, or through the balancing of the four humors. Treatments were to be modified according to the patient's constitution and included bleeding, purging, and then taking an herbal tincture of wormwood, castor, and rue, as well as laudanum at night. He also suggested drinking water impregnated with metals such as iron and steel to strengthen the blood, as well as daily horseback riding. Both Willis and Sydenham's ideas worked through England and Scotland during the 1700s. This period is known as the Georgian era, and you may recognize it as the time in which Jane Austen's novels take place. Intellectualism was blooming all over Europe during this time of scientific revolution. New theories were being proposed on almost everything, and much of the medicine was focused on the nervous system, thanks to increased knowledge of neuroanatomy and psychology. The physicians of the time still weren't sure how the nervous system worked, but knew all thought, sensation, and perception traveled through the central nervous system. They also knew that if there was a fault in that system, some type of breakdown could occur. By the 1730s, the idea of nervous distempers was widespread. The word distemper again harkens back to the four humors and the temperaments associated with them. These nervous disorders were a combination of mental and physical complaints that would today most likely be thought of as psychosomatic, or caused by a mental factor such as internal conflict or stress, or psychoneurotic, meaning they were caused by an emotional conflict that's being suppressed and therefore seeks expression through a disguised response or symptom. There were four main distempers: hysteria, hypochondria, the spleen, and the vapors, but there was no clear demarcation between them. There were also four separate, more severe pathologies known as mania, frenzy, delirium, and madness. Developments in social theory were also affected by this huge interest in the nervous system. The moralism movement was on the rise, in which pity, benevolence, and empathy replaced previous emotional severity and materialist rationalism. In London, Edinburgh, Oxford, and Cambridge, a kind of nervous culture formed in which nervous conditions of both men and women were accepted, almost prized, instead of stigmatized. Men who were fluent in feeling were now valued as being well-bred and of elevated morality, Hence, diagnoses of hypochondria were often more frequent among the rich. These well-bred men were said to have more refined nerves and therefore experienced emotion better, but were also subject to nervous collapse. Hysteria in women, however, was still diagnosed more frequently than hypochondriasis and was considered a more serious condition. Sexuality was completely absent from Georgian literature on hysteria and the nerves. It was not a cause, factor, or treatment. This is possibly due to the condition affecting both sexes. However, this idea later vanished in the first half of the 19th century. But we'll get to that in a moment. For now, let's pause for a word from our sponsors. Our regular sponsor is Audible.com. Audible can provide you with interesting and engaging audiobooks. In fact, there are over 180,000 of them to choose from, which you can listen to on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or other MP3 players. MCP listeners can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial of Audible.com by going to www.audibletrial.com/MCP. You can also find this link on our Facebook page and website. If you sign up for the free trial, you get a free audiobook that is yours to keep, even if you cancel the service as soon as you finish downloading it. And the MCP gets the funding it needs to keep bringing morbid history to your ears. So go get your free audiobook on us. Lastly, if you like this podcast, why not sponsor the MCP yourself by becoming a patron on Patreon? There are several tiers of patronage, the lowest being $1 an episode. With that dollar, you become eligible for several rewards, such as access to our patron-only feed and being entered in a monthly raffle. When you become a patron, it helps us keep this show going. If more people become patrons, we may even be able to eliminate the need for sponsors. That means no break in the middle of the show. If you'd like to become a patron, go to bit.ly/morbidpatron, that's bit.ly/morbidpatron, and you'll be directed to our Patreon page, where you can choose your rewards. You'll have our eternal gratitude. And now, back to the podcast. The Enlightenment, which occurred between the late 1600s and early 1700s, is also described as an age of reason. But even with the rise of intellectualism and emotion, the role of women was still considered to be one of homemaking and childbearing, and hysteria was also still firmly ingrained as a female ailment. Georgian women were held to a high standard of manners, behavior, and even language and gesture. The smallest gestures at social events could be interpreted as flirtation or irritation. This social pressure was deemed the cause of their hysteria. Hysteria was also linked to modernization and westernization. Feelings of self-blame, low self-esteem, and helplessness were associated with the rapid social change from a feudal economy to an industrial one. In fact, areas and sometimes entire countries were seen as more modern if the rate of hysteria was high there. In 1748, Joseph Roland, a French physician, published a work that stated that hysteria was caused by foul air in big cities and an unruly social life. Women who lived in the country were less likely to suffer from it as they did hard physical work, didn't think too much about philosophy, and contented themselves in their role as mother and wife. Urban living, he stated, created a desire for pleasure, and this exhausted the body into a nervous state. This urban living could also make men hysterical, which, in Roland's opinion, made them effeminate. The cure was submitting to the prescribed social roles and embracing domestic duties. Other French physicians at the time, such as Pierre Roussel, agreed. Roussel stated that femininity was a natural and essential desire for women, and because of the development of major cities and modern life, femininity was disrupted, causing lethargy, melancholy, and hysteria. Even Philippe Pinal, the French physician and humanitarian who in 1974 removed the chains of the female hysteria patients he oversaw at the Salpêtrière Sanitarium in Paris, regarded hysteria as the result of excessive exposure to social and psychological stresses, and mainly a female condition. The longest research study on hysteria was conducted by French physician Pierre Briquet, who worked at La Charité Hospital in Paris and is known mostly for his work on infectious diseases. Over the course of 10 years, from 1849 to 1859, Briquet studied hysteria patients, both male and female. His treatise on hysteria was published in 1859 and was received respectfully by his Parisian contemporaries. In this work, he stated that there was no connection between the sexual organs and hysteria, therefore it could affect men as well, but he also believed this was due to the affected man being sickly and abnormal. Aside from this, Briquet advanced the theory that hysteria was caused by the complex and highly individual interaction of many disparate factors, including age, gender, emotional disposition, family history, mode of education, previous physical illnesses, and psychological stress. This was a huge step toward understanding all forms of mental illness. Briquet's book was praised, but quickly eclipsed by the rising psychotherapy movement, which we'll talk about in a moment. While many of these theories seem infuriatingly sexist and misogynistic to us in the modern age, keep in mind that this was the social norm of the time. Some of the women who were diagnosed with hysteria felt relief at finally being able to put a name to the inexplicable symptoms they were experiencing and receiving some form of treatment. Also, even though hysteria was still mostly associated with females, it was no longer thought to be caused by merely possessing a uterus, but instead a condition of the nerves, and through the trials surrounding it, many other forms of mental illness and eventually effective treatments for those illnesses were identified, but there was still a long way to go before this occurred. The Victorian era began in 1837 with the crowning of Queen Victoria. This period was marked by an increase in imperial expansion by Britain, as well as a strong religious drive for moral reform. The moral treatment movement inspired the development of non-invasive, non-restraint-based therapeutic methods of treatment for mental illness. Before this time, asylums used physical restraint, isolation, and what is modernly considered abuse in attempt to treat what was then called madness. People thought to be suffering from hysteria often ended up in these asylums. If you'd like further insight into the asylum era of medicine in Victoria, Australia, check out our previous episode on that subject. During this period, industrialism was on the rise, as was communication, thanks to the railway, steam-powered ships, the telegraph, and photography. Social rationalism declined and was replaced by romanticism and mysticism, and the home began to be thought of as a refuge from the harsh world. Men and women were even more markedly separated in middle and high-class society, with women being sequestered to domestic duties. This, in turn, affected the practice of medicine, which was also improving thanks to new methods of sanitation and pain management. Because of the strict social codes, where women were expected to be subservient to their husbands or fathers, diagnoses of hysteria reached their peak, as women acting outside the social norms were thought of as sick. Common 19th and early 20th century symptoms of hysteria included fits, teeth grinding, mutism, cold extremities, limb pain, excessive laughing, choking, tearing of hair, emotional instability with no apparent cause, vomiting, anorexia, hallucinations, twitching, cataleptic rigidity, paralysis, and unwomanly behavior, such as being a suffragette. Sadly, womb movement is still mentioned at this time, despite a more widespread knowledge of anatomy. One constant in the history of hysteria is that the symptoms seemed to have no other apparent medical cause. The treatment of hysteria was the main subject of a field of psychiatry that would soon become known as psychotherapy. Psychotherapy is a psychological method of treatment for mental illness, emphasizing personal interaction and talking about a person's problems in order to change behavior. It was championed by several psychiatrists, especially Sigmund Freud, but I'll get to him in a moment. thanks to the moral treatment movement and the rise of what would be called psychotherapy, many mental illnesses were reevaluated, and hysteria was one of these. Jean-Martin Charcot, who is often called the father of neurology, is said to have scientificized hysteria in the 1880s in France. Early in his career, Charcot believed hysteria was due to a lesion or injury to the nervous system. But later he revised this theory, stating that it was purely psychological and caused by trauma. He theorized that there were two distinct forms of hysteria among women who were not considered otherwise insane: major hysteria and minor hysteria. Major hysteria included symptoms such as violent muscular contractions, paralysis, mutism, retention of urine, anesthesia, and blindness. Loss of appetite, menstrual difficulties, and fainting were symptoms of minor hysteria. He believed the cause of both of these conditions was psychological in nature. Charcot also pushed for the diagnosis of hysteria among males. He felt that prejudice against the condition in men caused cases of male hysteria to go unnoticed, even by the most highly trained doctors. He felt it could occur even in what were thought of as the most masculine of males, such as railway engineers and soldiers. His theory of hysteria being caused by trauma paved the way for understanding neurological symptoms arising from accidents or war-related traumas, what we now call post-traumatic stress disorders. In Victorian Britain, however, Charcot's theories on male hysteria were radicalized, with proclamations that hysteria could only affect non-white males and that Anglo-Saxon men were immune. Germany had a similar response, saying French men were the most susceptible because they were infertile and weak. In any country, hysteria was used against the men of foreign countries, indigenous peoples, slaves, Jewish people, and colonial populations, accusing them of being susceptible to it. Despite this early stigma, the diagnosis of male hysteria spread after the First World War, though its existence was still debated. Between 1875 and 1902, some 300 scholarly articles were published on male hysteria. In 1907, the label war neurosis was introduced for the condition specifically in soldiers. Shell shock was also coined in order to avoid using the word hysteria, which was thought to feminize the soldiers. Shell shock sufferers were still regarded as womanish, homosexual, or childish until after World War II, when the high incidence of shell shock waived much of the stigma. If you want to know more about the history of male hysteria and shell shock, there's an excellent book by Mike McHale called Hysterical Men: The Hidden History of Male Nervous Illness that I highly recommend. One of Charcot's students, Pierre Janet, was one of the first to theorize that events in a person's past could cause their present-day trauma. He also dedicated much study to the five symptoms that were considered typical of hysteria at the time: anesthesia, amnesia, abulia, which means an absence of willpower as well as indecisiveness, motor control disease, and modification of character. He believed something subconscious triggered hysteria, and that it wasn't always sex-related. He also noted that identification of a hysterical fit was often impossible, as it mimicked every other type of disease. Charcot and Janet's work partly inspired the work of Sigmund Freud, the famous Austrian neurologist and founder of psychoanalysis. His work, Studies on Hysteria, was published in 1895 and was co-authored by Josef Breuer, a distinguished neurophysicist. In the book, Freud theorized that hysteria was all due to a repressed memory of early childhood sexual abuse. Upon working with hundreds of patients who denied such abuse, he eventually abandoned this theory for one related to penis envy. He stated hysteria was symptomatic of a psychological scar produced through subconscious trauma and repression of the moment when females discovered they had no phallus and their subconscious struggle to reclaim that lost phallus. Women in his system of treatment were seen as the negated obverse of men, the castrated others whose lack of phallus condemned them to a life of seeking a replacement penis. Any objection to this theory was seen as a symptom of the condition. In his early career, Freud used hypnotism to help hysterical women recall their traumas, which could be either a large single event or many smaller events built up over the years. He stated that hysteria's many different symptoms were due to many different types of trauma. The treatments put forth by Freud consisted of talking about anything and everything, a therapy called free association, which has continued today as part of the treatment of both major and minor mental illnesses. Freud also suggested hysterical women could regain their lost phallus through marriage, sex with their husbands, and through having babies. American neurologist Silas Weir Mitchell, not to be confused with the Silas Weir Mitchell who plays Monroe in the NBC series Grimm, invented the most widely used treatment of the time, the rest cure. The treatment consisted primarily of isolation, confinement to a bed, dieting, electrotherapy, not electroconvulsive therapy, and massage. Fun-ish fact, Mitchell was the doctor of Charlotte Perkins Gilman, and it was his rest cure that inspired her to write her short story, The Yellow Wallpaper. Notice that among these treatments, orgasms, genital massage, and vibrators are not mentioned. One of the most popular books about hysteria, entitled The Technology of the Orgasm by Rachel Maines, claims that Victorian physicians routinely used electromechanical vibrators to stimulate female patients to orgasm as a treatment for hysteria. She stated that it wasn't considered sexual, as the vibrators were only used on the external genitalia, and that these vibrators supposedly saved physicians a lot of time and labor, as they had previously used their own hands. This theory is repeated often, but it's not supported by historical evidence. The inventor of the electric vibrator, Joseph Mortimer Granville, asserted that the intended use of his vibrator was for pain relief, the treatment of nerve disorders, irritability, indigestion, and constipation. Vibration therapy became popular among physicians and was used to treat a variety of ailments in both women and men. These included arthritis, amenorrhea, inflammation, tumors, and hysteria, but there is no written record of it being used to induce orgasm in hysteria patients. Cases of stimulation to orgasm as a treatment for hysteria at the turn of the century, either by hand or vibrator, if they occurred at all, would have been confined to an extremely limited group. In 2018, Hallie Lieberman, a sex and gender historian, and Eric Schatzberg published a peer-reviewed article that found no evidence to support Maine's claims, even in the book's own citations. They called the wide acceptance of Maine's book a fundamental failure of academic quality control. While historical sources do support claims that Victorian doctors used vibrators to treat upwards of 300 different diseases, none of the diseases were cured by vibrators, and the vibrators were used on both men and women. Lieberman also found that the vibrators were more likely used for the relief of menstrual cramps than for anything related to hysteria, and that this myth is primarily rooted in sexual fantasy. In the 20th century, the number of females diagnosed with hysteria sharply declined. With the rise in knowledge surrounding the brain, psychology, and psychiatry, physicians could not find a way to connect a specific set of symptoms to the disorder. Elliot Slater, a British psychiatrist and pioneer in the field of genetics and mental disorders, rejected hysteria in 1961, concluding that the diagnosis of hysteria was a disguise for the ignorance of earlier physicians. Even at this time, he was criticized for this view. In 1965, Ilse Weith published her book on the history of hysteria, and in 1986, Etienne Trillat also published a book on the history of hysteria. These two works became the definitive histories on the subject, and unfortunately are the source of the many errors in translation of the Hippocratic texts. In the 1980s, women tried to reclaim the term hysteria, using its history as a symbol of the systematic oppression of women. In this view, hysteria and its symptoms were a pre-feminist rebellion against the social roles placed upon women. It was established as a condition of women who objected to the patriarchy or failed to act or develop, quote, normally, which was then labeled as pathologic. Today, female hysteria is no longer a recognized condition. The diagnosis was removed from the DSM-3, the third edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, in 1980. Some of the different symptoms of what was previously labeled as hysteria are now recognized as other conditions, such as schizophrenia, borderline personality disorder, menopause, migraines, anxiety, depression, anorexia, and conversion disorder. The rest, such as sexually forward behavior, disinterest in sex, and emotionality, have been acknowledged as variations of normal human behavior. Even with a two-part episode, there is so much more to know about hysteria, so I want to recommend an excellent resource if you want more information. It's called Hysteria Beyond Freud, and it was written by a team of scholars, Gilman, King, Porter, Russo, and Showalter. This book is informative and incredibly interesting to read. So, what was hysteria if not a real condition? A disguise for ignorance, as Elliot Slater states? An unspoken protest or method of oppression, as some feminists theorize? For some patients, a real malady was mistaken for hysteria with fatal consequences. For others, it gave a name to the inexplicable symptoms they had, while still for others, it was used as a way to remove or control them. Either way, its long history, its past association with witchcraft, and its modern mental health and misogynistic connotations bring out the curiosity in us. The Morbid Curiosity Podcast was produced by H. Lloyd. If you'd like to get in touch or suggest a morbid topic for me to talk about, you can tweet the show at Morbid Podcast or find us on Facebook and Instagram at Morbid Curiosity Podcast. If you like the show, please share us on social media and please, please, please give us a rating on iTunes. Your shares and ratings help us reach new listeners and expand this wonderfully creepy community. Thank you to everyone who commented, suggested topics, shared MCP posts, liked or followed the MCP on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and gave us ratings on iTunes. People like Andrew, Amanda, Fiona, Rich, Michaela, Bailey, Stephen, Christina, Theon Starkfan, Peachy, Aubrey, Nicola, Marie, and Elizabeth. Tony and Christy have my eternal gratitude for becoming patrons on Patreon. Thank you. Because of you, the listeners, our creepy community is growing, especially on Facebook, so head over there to engage with other listeners, discuss episodes and news articles, and share your own creepy stories and cute pet pictures. The MCP is part of a wider creepy community known as the Belfry Podcast Network. Check out the other shows on the Belfry Network at www.thebelfry.rip. As I said before, if you really like the MCP, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. You can also give one-time donations by going to our website, www.morbidcuriositypodcast.com, and clicking the donate button. On our website, you can also find links to all our social media and sponsors, and other ways to contact us. If you'd rather contact us by mail, this address is also listed on the website. Another way to help the show is by going to our Amazon wishlist at bit.ly/morbidwishlist. On this list are items that will help us improve the podcast, improve our workspace, and some things that are just for fun. Any purchases from this list are greatly appreciated. We are eternally grateful for your support. My name is Hallie, and until next time, thanks for listening.